virtual format, you know, kudos to you. That's really awesome. And I, boy, I'm really sorry I missed out on the poker last night. It looks like you guys had a great time. That's pretty cool stuff. So, you know, we talked about this a little bit yesterday, but my background is as an engineer. I've been a consulting engineer for about 35 years plus. Had my own business for more than 20 of that. And I got really excited about this coaching about 12 years ago. Of course, you know, just like you guys do with your teams, there's a certain amount of coaching you do all the time. I had to do that. I really enjoyed it a lot. Not everybody does. And I decided, hey, this is something that's really, really exciting to me. We began to look at an exit strategy out of our engineering company. The timing was right. We did that in 2015. And I've been providing business coaching to my clients on a full-time basis since then. And absolutely just having a blast with it. And I think that probably came through a little bit yesterday when I was talking about goals and the commitment and the passion and the why. You know, I just feel like it's really important that that we enjoy life, that we have fun. You know, we all have to work. That's just part of it. But we want to have a good time with it. I was meeting with a client this morning, and of course, it is that time of the year as we enter into the new year coming up, gosh, in like 3.5 weeks. And we were talking about goals. And so it was really, you know, just building on what I talked about with your group yesterday. What we talked about yesterday is what I do in real life every day with my clients. You know, today we're going to take a little bit different turn. You know, I've kind of labeled it steps to a more productive day. And as I go through this, you know, some of you guys are going to say, wow, that's so obvious. I do that. Everybody does that. But what I've discovered, you know, over the years in training my teams and coaching clients is to never make assumptions about what people know or don't know. I'm constantly surprised that some of the most obvious things to me, at least, based on my experiences through my professional career, were so obvious to me that the next person has never thought about it. A lot of the things that we have to do in business, you guys know this, we don't learn this in school. We learn it in the school of hard knocks. And, you know, depending on who your mentors are, you may or may not be exposed to some of these things. So, you know, so we're going to go a little bit different direction today. Like yesterday, I encourage you to keep a notepad handy. You know, think about the things that I'm saying. How can I apply this to me or my teams? How can I use these tools perhaps to be more effective? Again, it may just give you that light bulb idea that makes you more efficient in 2021. And if we accomplish that and you get one or two ideas out of this, then we will have been successful. Again, I went through this yesterday a little bit. We won't spend a lot of time on it, but anybody that maybe is new to us this morning, enhancing your Zoom experience, I certainly encourage you to you know, go up to the top part of the screen and select view options and choose side-by-side mode, and then go up to the upper right-hand side of the screen and where it says view options and choose side-by-side mode. And then again, you can increase or decrease the size of those two windows where you can see the shared slides on about 60 or 65% of the screen. And then, you know, me on the other 30 or 35% as well. And I think that makes for a lot better experience for you. And then, of course, feel free to use the chat function as well. I think most of you guys are probably familiar with that. So someone asked me, you know, the other day, since you've been coaching full time, what's one commonality that you found among your clients? And the answer was really easy for me. Number one is they don't feel like they're being overly productive and that they're overwhelmed and frustrated. They can't get everything done. They're overwhelmed with tasks, ideas, initiatives, meetings, calls, interruptions, disruptions. I'm sure you guys can add even more to that list. You jump around a lot from task to task, sometimes without a plan. And some days it's just really hard to get traction. This isn't unique to startups or new entrepreneurs. It's a problem that seasoned business pros have as well. And I bet a lot of you guys can identify with this. And unfortunately, there's really not an easy fix. We have to change our habits. I mean, that's what it comes down to. We have to change our habits. So, you know, my engineering background, I'm a process guy. So it goes without saying that my productivity tools are mostly process driven. And when I ask my clients, what is the most important thing that you can help me accomplish in 2021? They say without fail, help me with my processes. And so this morning, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about some of the trusted systems that I use and that I recommend to my clients. So I was first introduced to this concept of trusted systems by the book Getting Things Done by David Allen. The concept is that you develop these processes and habits that are so foolproof that you don't even have to think about them. You know that they work and you trust them implicitly. And so I want to note for you guys, these are my trusted systems, the things that I trust and rely upon. Each of us have different trusted systems, and you know, you may have some that you use, and that's awesome. Again, this morning, I'm going to share with you what some of mine are, give you a little bit of background on them. And I think we're going to have some time here for discussion as well after. One of the things you're going to find about me is I keep things really, really simple. I've tried a lot of different things over the years and developed a lot of different processes. And as I look back over my career, the things that have been the most effective were simple and intuitive. They had to be easy to use, and most importantly, had to add value. I'm reminded a system that we developed with our engineering company. It was a very simple system, and it was every time we started a new client, we had a new project form. It was a standard form we used for every client. You guys probably have one in your businesses as well that you use for every client. And we kept it so simple that everyone in the office could use it. I didn't want there to be any confusion about that, because we wanted to start that client relationship right out of the gate. And so that was really important to us. And I thought everybody did this until we merged with a larger engineering company when we sold our company in 2015. I continued to work with them for a couple of years, and they were about twice the size we were. And I found out very quickly they didn't have a process for that. Every one of their teams and every one of their offices did it differently. Needless to say, it was a mess. I couldn't believe that they had operated that way for 60 years. And we brought our system into theirs and made it way much more efficient for them and really changed that. So that was really one of those examples where, gosh, I just thought everybody did it. It was just so obvious to us, but it wasn't. You know, too many of the lists that we read about having a productive day really only focus on the day. And so I'm going to start with something that I consider to be critical. And so my first trusted system is the brain dump. Before you can have a productive day, you have to get rid of all the clutter. I'm not just talking about on your desk, although I like to think that a clean desk is a little bit easier to work on. But I'm talking about all that clutter that's going on in your head. The human brain is really incredible at processing information. Most of us only tap into a small percentage of our brain power. The brain is not intended to be a filing cabinet or a to-do list, but many of us use it that way. I know I did. I thought that I could remember everything. And so the first thing I do with most of my coaching clients is a brain dump. I want to get everything out of your head. But before I start with the brain dump, I want to share the number one office accessory that I recommend. And if you don't have this in your office, I want you to go out and get it today or before the end of the week. Although I suspect that most of you guys probably have this. About 18 months ago, I started working with a client who I had known for a while. He suggested that we meet in his office. And I said, okay, under one condition. It's important that we have a whiteboard to work on. He said, what size? Of course, I said the bigger the better. And if you have room for a 4x8 sheet of melamine, that would be awesome. He texted me a photo later in the day and asked, will this do? Imagine, if you will, a whiteboard 4 foot tall by 16 foot long on one wall. There were two other walls with 4x8 boards. And I really wish I had kept a copy of those photos because it was really cool. So, you know, back to my client, we filled three of those boards up in our first meeting. He had multiple businesses, nonprofit and personal interest. And his picture was in the dictionary next to the word overwhelmed. That's why he hired me. The fourth board ended up being used in his office as an open issues and task list for the small team that he shared his office with. Very similar, you know, to the screen image that I've put up there now. One of my clients placed a whiteboard in his warehouse where his crews start every day. It provides a reminder for them for priorities, outstanding fill-in tasks, as well as for them, a place to highlight a job well done in a more informal way. They also use it as part of their weekly team meeting. But I love that they put this board in there and they use it in such an informal way, and everybody's invited to participate in it. And it really serves a lot of good things for their culture. So just real quickly in the chat, you know, I want to engage you guys a little bit. How many of you guys are using whiteboards in your offices, conference rooms, or workshops? And maybe what are some of the ways that you guys use your whiteboard? Any thoughts on that? Any takers? Scott, I bet you guys use a whiteboard in the sales office.
Yeah, we for sure do. A lot of the time we use it for as a goal, setting goals for the most part, or objectives for the year, maybe specials or promotions that we're offering, as well as features and advantages and benefits of our product versus the competition is a lot of what Mike's been putting up on the board lately to go over why our product is so much superior to every other product that's out there. So that's how we use it anyway.
Awesome. Yeah, that's a great way to use it. You know, when I gave this presentation a few weeks ago to a group, someone mentioned that they had a large format erasable 12-month calendar on their wall that was really critical to keeping them on track for their goals for the year. And I, after that, I said, well, this is kind of cool. And I looked it up, and those 12-month calendars come in up to 4 foot by 8 foot sizes. And I thought, wow, what a powerful tool to use in an office or in several of your businesses where you're planning out jobs on a weekly, monthly basis. One of my architects that I work with a lot has a 24-foot long glass dry erase board across one of the walls of their conference room. The coaching client I was meeting with this morning has a large interior window in his office that we use as a dry erase board sometimes. It's really hard for me to walk past a glass wall without being tempted to start writing on it. And so a lot of different ways you can use these. I use a whiteboard personally in nearly every coaching session or workshop. And in person, my coaching conversation this morning was in person. We wrote all over the whiteboard. And at the end of the meeting, I captured that as a PDF image and put that in my file, shared that with my clients so they had the benefit of all that stuff. And virtually, I use a template that I've developed, or, you know, there's whiteboard options in most of the digital meeting formats. Zoom has a whiteboard option that really works pretty well. I'm seeing a few comments in here. You know, Brandon indicating they probably need to use a whiteboard a little more. Brandon, if you don't mind unmuting, you said something about Engstrom Siding has a tool in their office. Can you share what that is? I'm putting you on the spot.
Yeah, so I'm not 100% sure of it, but I think it's like a magnetic whiteboard. And they just do it, and it's a 12-month calendar for them. And they can, I think they have it itemized out. I actually just was texting Chris. I'm not sure if he's on the call or not, but it's basically so they could schedule per crew, and it gives them that 12-month view, because in a lot of our businesses right now, we're out a lot further, you know, 12 months. I mean, we're definitely out 12 months in Duluth. You know, I know that's the case alongside of a lot of other dealers out there. So to have that picture for the guys to see the whole thing, I mean, we have a 6-week view, and that just doesn't cut it at this point, because all they see is a job stacking up. They can't materialize that to say, okay, this is what I'm shooting for. I'm going to get all these jobs done, you know, and that's something that, you know, I can see being a huge benefit, and something that we're strongly looking into in Duluth. And I mean, even Scott and I were just talking about this a couple of days ago too. So the production calendar for whiteboards, like having a whiteboard, have it something like that, to me could be, you know, kind of a really good option for a lot of us. So.
Yeah, that's awesome, Brandon. And you make a really good point. The magnetic ones are really cool as well. So that you really end up using that like a bulletin board. And you can use the magnets to hold things up on the wall as well. Thanks for sharing that. That is fabulous. You know, Lauren indicated in the chat that, you know, they use it to track their year-to-date sales and sales goals. And she indicated it's great to, you know, for instilling that competitiveness. And I think, Lauren, like we talked about yesterday, it provides a great way to hold people accountable as well. In a very positive way. You know, one of the things I like to do is I don't like to be a disciplinarian at all. I like to treat this all like it's business. And so, you know, let's just have good, strong accountability, and that competitive, you know, peer pressure is a good way to do that as well. So, yeah, thank you for sharing that. I really appreciate that, guys. And listen up, I'll provide other opportunities in here too for you guys to share as well. And so, you know, going back to the brain dump, I love the whiteboard. The brain dump is exactly what you might imagine. We unload all of the issues and tasks that are cluttering your mind and put them down on the whiteboard. And depending on the client, I might ask the following questions. You know, articulate in one sentence what brings you joy. What value do you bring to the world? Because again, that's really important to me. List all of the things that you're currently doing or would like to do, business or professional. So it kind of begins that bucket list thing. In essence, what would you like to accomplish in the next year or 3 years or before you retire? And so again, that's more on a personal side, on a team side, might be the, you know, outstanding task or issues that you have. I really love to do brain dumps with teams. It's a great way for me to find out what's going on in everybody's minds. And I record everything they say on the whiteboard. We seldom use everything that gets recorded, but we acknowledge and record everything that is offered. First, because at the brain dump stage, I don't really know what's going to be important or how it might connect with other things. And secondly, I want to make sure that I acknowledge everyone's contribution. You know, some of your team members, it's really hard for them to speak up and offer those ideas or solutions. And when they do, I want to acknowledge and appreciate that they've done that. And we may not use what they've said, but I want to make sure that that we acknowledge it. And so a few things happen when you unload all this stuff from your head. First, wow, it's really quite a relief. It's amazing what a load that lifts off your shoulders, getting that out of your head and onto a board. Secondly, when we look at things visually, we begin to see some connections that we never saw before. And this definitely applies to how your teams might see things. And then third, as I've shared, I begin to rely on the brain dump as part of my trusted system, a place to capture all that stuff and not have it clutter my brain on an ongoing basis. Again, the brain's really great at processing, but it's not a good filing cabinet. For me, I don't use any set format for my first brain dump. It can sometimes be really random. on an ongoing basis, my brain dump takes on a little bit more structure, although they still have a fair amount of randomness. You know, the image I shared on the screen, I just kind of did a sample of what an ABC seamless brain dump might be. And I split it into three areas. May or may not be appropriate for you guys, but I said, hey, in the office and marketing side of things, what are some of the issues and tasks and things that are out there? And then in the shop or in the field, what are some of the things? And so that's a great way to do that. So this next slide is brain dump that I did with a client. And you don't need to adjust your screens or anything. I've kind of dulled the slides out a little bit, so I didn't give away anybody's particular information. But this may give you an idea of how free this format can be. And this was actually the 4-foot by 16-foot board. And so we covered a lot of territory on that board. That was our first meeting, and we just got everything out of his head. That was our whole goal, was just get everything out there. And we drew lines everywhere and did timelines and looked at different things. The next slide was our next meeting. And you can see that it was a little more organized. We took the 5 or 6 key areas that we identified in our first meeting, and we began to expand on them using kind of a mini SWOT analysis for each of the areas. And through this process, we were able to help him find a little bit more clarity in what he was trying to accomplish with the various parts of his business and his life. And I can tell you several months later, as a result of that, he made some pretty significant changes in his life and decided to move out of a couple of business interests that he had, decided to focus a little more energy on one of the nonprofits he was involved with. And he and I had a follow-up meeting here about 3 weeks ago, and he is just absolutely loving life. But it all started with this brain dump. And just to show you that there's no required format, I wanted to show you another brain dump that a very creative client of mine did. Now, I was a suspect most of us as engineers and contractors, this probably isn't the way our brain dumps are going to look. But this was earlier in the year, just at the beginning of the pandemic, and we were meeting by Zoom, just like this call. And I posed those same questions to her. What brings you joy? How do you add value to the world? What are you currently doing? What would you like to be doing or accomplishing? And what outstanding tasks are driving you nuts? And I knew that she was an artist and a free spirit. I didn't expect this. I really expected a flip chart or, you know, a Word document outline. Usually most of my clients are really at a loss for words, and I kind of have to drag the info out of them. But this wasn't the case with Tricia. She sent me this piece of, and I'll call it artwork, and it did take me a little time to decipher, but all of the information is there. And more importantly, it showed me a very personal side of her that the words alone couldn't show. And so the brain dump's a great starting point for developing personal and business goals. Gives you an easy list to identify items to delegate or to outsource. Some liken the brain dump to a master to-do list. I do a mini brain dump every 3 to 4 weeks for myself, or anytime like I feel like I'm starting to get a little bit overwhelmed and I need a reset. I use a combination of my whiteboard in my office and my planner, which I'm going to talk about in a few minutes. And so, you know, Paul, I wanted to acknowledge you. You've noted in the chat, you guys use it for your production team so they can see monthly production numbers. And I love anytime I can see the word goals, I love it. And again, that word competition comes up amongst the crews, and so that competitive spirit, everybody loves that. We love games, and that that accountability as well. And so the second trusted process for me is my digital calendar. And years ago, when my hair wasn't quite as gray and white, I could remember everything. I always tell people now, I can't remember things because my hard drive's full. And so that's my excuse. But I seldom had to take notes, and I could seemingly, you know, just pull things out of thin air. And I suspect some of you guys are that same way. So this is just a snapshot of 1 week in my digital calendar. And again, I've purposely blurred it out so I don't overwhelm you with the details of my life. But I tell you today, if it's not on my calendar, it doesn't happen. I'm religious about entering everything in my calendar with as much information as I can in the notes. And, you know, if I get an email that needs to be a calendar event, I digitally move it to my calendar so that I get all the included content. I take the time to put searchable address and phone numbers in there if I have them, so that when I'm out in the field, I can just pull my phone up, and if I'm searching for an address, it's right there on my calendar event, and I can go ahead and use MapQuest or whatever for that. And what's cool about this is the ability to put something in and not worry about it. Again, I want to make sure that it doesn't clutter my brain. So I mentioned yesterday, I'm a Chamber of Commerce ambassador. And pre-pandemic, we might have 2 to 5 ribbon cuttings or events scheduled in any given week, in addition to my regularly scheduled items. Because all of the detail was included in the calendar event, I never had to worry about having what I needed. I knew that it was always there. You can see on the image, I categorize and color code most of my calendar events so that at a glance, I can tell what my day looks like. I keep my categories really simple. Networking events, coaching, chamber of commerce, time blocking, family, those types of things. I don't want it, you know, to look crazy. I just want to be able to tell really, really quickly what my day looks like. And I'm going to give you a really helpful hint here. If I have a business event that's outside of my normal working hours, I always invite my wife to that calendar event so that it shows up on her calendar. If I just tell her about it, she'll probably forget and I'll be in trouble for not telling her. And so I make sure to invite her. And that's just a little hint that I learned years ago. The other thing about calendars is I keep one calendar and I keep it really simple. I know some people keep a separate work calendar, a home calendar, and I strongly discourage this. This may work, you know, for some people where work and life doesn't overlap, but in today's world, I don't think that's the case for most of us. Multiple calendars are really the recipe for missing an appointment. And I know people tell me all the time, we have the technology, we can sync multiple calendars. And I've been there, I've done that. And honestly, I think it's magic. Sometimes I think all this computer stuff is magic, but I don't deal in magic. I deal in simple. I've inadvertently shared all of my doctor's appointments with my team. I keep it simple. If someone else needs to be included in my calendar event, I invite them. I also use my calendar. This is really important. I use my calendar to establish boundaries. This is an important habit for me. I've established an ideal window of time for meeting with coaching clients. I've established an ideal window of time for having prospect meetings. These are predetermined blocks of time, and they're my starting points when I'm scheduling appointments. I find it a whole lot easier to say no if I've established those boundaries. And will I schedule a prospect meeting or a coaching call outside of those boundaries? Absolutely. But I do it on my terms and I consciously make those exceptions. One boundary I have is I don't schedule ongoing coaching calls or Mondays or Fridays. Those are my days. And you can see on the display, I have nothing scheduled on Monday. Those are my personal days. I could talk for an hour or so about time blocking, do's and don'ts. And that would be a discussion for a whole nother time. The other thing is I try not to mix Microsoft and Google. I don't want to learn multiple platforms. I want to learn one system. I'm an Outlook guy, and I'm glad that Microsoft has kept up reasonably with the other options. I do have a Gmail account, but it works perfectly inside of Outlook. Almost all of the scheduling calendars work seamlessly with Outlook and Google. I just started using Calendly to do some of my calendar invites. And it works great with Outlook. I mentioned this before, and it was mentioned here, I think Brandon mentioned too, you know, this idea of a yearly planning calendar, whether it's on the wall or digital. And I, you know, I think Brandon mentioned that they've got one that's a 1 year. Another one of my architect friends does a lot of design for public schools. And those projects have to fit the school calendar, since he uses a 3 year calendar. And you know, I have a whole other presentation just about managing your digital life and tips and tricks and how you can become more efficient with Outlook and those types of things. You know, I may mention this a little bit later as well. I get a little bit off script here, but one of the most important things I think about trusted systems is you have to really engage yourself in it and trust it completely. One of the things I've done with Outlook is I've made sure and trained myself on how to use Outlook. It's one of my trusted systems. You know, yesterday, Jeff Lennon gave a great presentation on that sales and marketing tool that is available to you guys and that some of the franchises use. And if I was a franchisee and I bought that system, I would make sure that I did all of the training plus some to make sure I knew that system inside out, and so that I trusted that implicitly, so that when I sat down in front of a customer, I didn't have to fumble around with it. And that's really key. And so that's really, you know, probably the biggest takeaway I want to leave you with on this today on trusted systems is really invest the time you need to make those truly trusted. So the third trusted system I want to share with you this morning, and again, this is going to one of those, you're going to say, gosh, guys, this is so simple. Why is he even spending time on this? But the third trusted system is my daily planner. And as much as I'm tied to a digital calendar, I do not use a digital planner. I use a simple free format written composition book that I pick up at Walmart for 75 cents. I've tried digital platforms and they just don't work for me. I will say I'm fascinated by some of the notepads. I think Remarkable is one of them that you physically write or draw on and then you can automatically upload it to a digital record. Do you get any of you guys use some of those smart paper planners like Remarkable? You know, I'm going to keep rolling along here, but if you do, go ahead and pop that in the chat and let me know how it's working for you and what maybe some of the pros and cons are. You guys may convince me. Yeah, so Ted does. You know, some people use them. I've had clients use them and be very effective with them. You know, I guess I'm a little old school. I've got years of daytimer records going back from the 80s and 90s. And it was a true tried and true platform that's worked really well for me. Now don't get me wrong. I love technology. I use the cloud for storage. And every document on my computer is synced and available anywhere that I go. I'll take this another step. In my day planner, if there's a page of notes that I want to memorialize, I'll go ahead and scan that using a scanning app on my phone and automatically put that into my system so that I have it. You know, I mentioned a little bit about Jeff's system yesterday. You know, I know some of you guys are probably using some project management systems on your tablets that you have on the job. And a lot of these systems are really comprehensive and can cover a lot of your needs. But I don't think they completely erase the need for these other notes. I have a client with a national pest control company that really has an awesome project management and CRM system available to him. But he started using the written planner like I do, and he's find that it's made him better organized and things don't drop through the cracks for him. And he uses his project management and CRM system for its intended uses and his written planner for everything else. You know, again, you know, if you guys are using a project management system or a CRM system, just make sure that you do the tutorials, that you really know it inside and out so that you can really trust that system. I have an independent insurance agent client that has access to the company's CRM system. And I found out that he was only using just a small piece of it. And it was because he had never taken the time to do the tutorial. And with a little bit of guidance and a 1 hour tutorial, it is changing the way he manages his prospecting and his customer relations. And so making those investments is really important. You know, there's hundreds of productivity tools that are out there available to all of us. But we're only going to use the ones that we trust implicitly. I can think about the number of apps I've downloaded on my phone over the years. So many of them I just don't use because they either didn't do exactly what I wanted or I didn't invest the time to really learn how to use them. I wanted to make sure that, I try to keep it pretty simple now. A real quick story. One of my clients has a bookkeeper that works for them. And each week they have a financial meeting. And primarily that financial meeting is review the accounts receivable, the accounts payable, and invoicing. And this bookkeeper, a super nice person, but she didn't always enter all of the outstanding bills into the accounting program. She would just leave them in her inbox if she didn't think they had enough money to pay for them. And so after a little while, they discovered that the AP didn't always reflect everything. It first came to light when I asked them about my invoice, and they said, well, that's never shown up in the AP. We assume you'd been paid. And then second, after the IRS called them about outstanding payroll withholdings, the partners no longer trusted the numbers. They no longer trusted their own financial systems. And if we had time this morning, I could share so many other stories about that. So my writ and composition planner, it's simple. I purchase them at Walmart. How I use my planner, and I did this last night, planning for today. I've got a really full day today. I start a new page, and you can see it, a new page every day. I place the date in the upper right-hand corner, and then I use as many pages as necessary for each day. Sometimes it's one page, sometimes it's four or five pages, but I always start a new page each day. Next, I list an appointment, every appointment with a time. I include any time that I've blocked out for specific activities like marketing calls or special projects or, meeting with a team member. You guys just heard me say I use my digital calendar and I trust that implicitly. I also take that information from my digital calendar and I write it in my day planner. And it seems like that's a little redundant, but it helps me really engage with what my day is going to be. Just that mere act of writing it down really makes a difference. Just like we talked about yesterday about writing down your goals. It really makes a difference when you write this stuff down. So after I've written down the list of appointments, then I list those 3 to 5 to-do items that I really want to accomplish in any given day. And this becomes my plan for the day. That's my plan. There are some things that are on my digital calendar that may not make the cut. A lot of times those are things that maybe somebody else placed on my calendar, or they may have a much lower priority than my to-dos. But again, the process of writing things down really gives me my marching orders for the day. And I'm mostly in complete control. And I've established the goals and the boundaries for the day. All of the notes that I take during the day, my day planner is open right next to me right now. Any note that I take during the day is put in that day planner. And so it really begins to act a little bit more like a journal or a diary than a planner. I don't keep a separate notepad on the corner of my desk for random notes. Those notes go in my planner. I don't have random post-it notes all over my desk or on my computer screen. Those go in my planner. If I use a post-it note or somebody hands me a post-it note, I stick it in my planner. If I jot something down on a random notepad, and it does happen sometimes, I just tape or staple the note into my planner. For me, I check things off as I complete them. That kind of makes me feel empowered, but that's just me. I draw a circle next to the things that I didn't complete or maybe I've deferred. And at the end of the day, this is really important. It's an important habit for me. I try to write a gratitude statement. Writing a daily gratitude is one of my 2020 goals. Sometimes instead of the gratitude, I may discover a neat quote. And in this case, you know, the quote that I wrote at the bottom of the page was, "The key to success is to focus on goals, not obstacles." For whatever reason, that really spoke to me that day. So as previously indicated, sometimes I do my brain dump in my planner. I'm a note-taking machine. I'm 60 years old. I just can't remember things like I used to. And second, taking notes, especially with clients and prospects and bosses, fills them with confidence that you're engaged and listening to them. And it really does change the conversation. I met with a prospective client here 3 or 4 weeks ago. Because he called me because he was overwhelmed. And as we met, I immediately noticed he took no notes. Well, actually he did. He pulled out a post-it note. He took one post-it note. Otherwise his desk was perfectly clean. Well, when we arrived, I had already discovered that we had double booked our meeting. And I had no confidence that anything would ever happen with that note that he just took. And so it's something that we're going to work on. And I'm going to implement a daily planner with him. So the last trusted system that I'm going to share with you today is what I call my weekly review. And the weekly review brings everything together. I recommend to my clients that they have a very structured weekly review agenda. This is probably the most important meeting that you will have every week, and you are the only one there. I think that your weekly team meeting is incredibly critical, but your weekly review meeting with just you is an imperative meeting. This is dedicated business me time, where I'm identifying my next steps and action items. And again, it's all about not having to deal with all this brain clutter. And so I have this process in place. And so what's on the agenda for my weekly review? And again, I use a written agenda, and all of my clients use a written agenda that they use as a checklist every week when they do their weekly review. So what's on your agenda is going to depend a little bit on your business, but here's some of the common things for me and my clients. Number one is a backward look at my daily planner or my journal. I flip back through the pages. What did I not get done? What did I accomplish? The things that I didn't get done, were they important or not important? Do I need to schedule them going forward? Sometimes the things that I didn't get done just go away. They may no longer be timely. Maybe they just seemed important at the time, but they're not important anymore. The second item on my weekly review is a forward look at next week's calendar, sometimes 2 weeks. And again, I can usually tell by the color coding on my digital calendar what kind of week I'm going to have. Where are there gaps or openings in the schedule? What days are going to be killers? Thirdly, I review my CRM. Who's up in the next 1 to 2 to 4 weeks? And what's my plan of attack? And I specifically list who I need to call, email, or follow up. Prospects, cold calls, leveraging referrals, my B&I networking meeting, and setting those meetings up. Then I list any prep that I need to do for next week's appointments. And I'm always looking for opportunities to delegate things and utilize the resources of my team, my extended team. Is there some prep I need to do for that meeting next Thursday? And who on my team can help me pull that together? And then on my agenda is a quick staff review of my direct reports. When is my next scheduled check-in with them? Because it's already on my calendar. I stress meeting with each one of your direct reports, you know, at least once every 3 weeks to just have that 20 to 30 minute conversation and just to check in. I don't want to be having meetings with my reports only when there's bad news. I want to just have reports all the time. And then another part of my weekly review is, what are the key performance indicators for my business and where am I at? Where am I at on my goals? Where am I at on my sales goals? Where am I at on my productivity? Again, that's going to vary a little bit from person to person. And then for me, a last item on my weekly review is for my BNI weekly networking meeting is I need to prepare my weekly presentation. It only takes me about 5 or 6 minutes to do, but if I put that off until Tuesday morning at 7:30, then it's probably not going to happen and I'm going to fumble through that meeting. So this weekly review is a really valuable tool that I think shouldn't be overlooked. For me, I schedule my weekly reviews for Friday mornings. This gives me, you know, the day to wrap up loose ends before the weekend. It allows me to go into the weekend already prepared for next week and not scrambling. I don't have the dreaded Sunday evening, oh shit, it's Monday again. I'm already prepared. I've already got that scoped out on Friday. Sometimes there was a point in my life that I did my weekly reviews on Saturday mornings. I went to my favorite coffee shop. I sat down and put together my weekly review, and it worked really well for me. Didn't cut into, you know, my family time and that type of thing. So, you know, as we wrap up today, you know, I shared a few of my trusted systems. You know, hopefully you guys got a little bit out of this. The brain dump, I think, is really, really important. It's a great way to get rid of clutter. I love doing this with my clients. Again, for me, a key trusted system for me is my digital calendar and time blocking and setting boundaries. My third trusted system is my written planner, journal, diary, whatever you might want to call it. And then the fourth is my weekly review. These trusted systems are all about dealing with the clutter and creating action. To continue to move forward week after week, month after month, requires actions, or as I like to say, next steps, and so that we can continue to be successful. And I'm flipping through, we're getting ready, really tight on time. I wanna flip through a couple of things here, make sure I don't miss anything. No, I think we're really pretty good. And so, you know, I went through a lot of stuff there. You know, what are, you know, if you don't mind sharing in the chat, what are some of the trusted systems that maybe you use that maybe I didn't touch on that somebody else might benefit from?
I'll start out again because we'll wait till a few responses come in. But it's a joke in our office. We got a few people that like to have, have the written planner, you know, and others that feel like they, the phone or the iPad's a better record-keeping device. I think it's kind of a hybrid, to be honest with you. You take notes and whatnot, and you can transpose those over to the computer. as far as running your calendar and making sure all your events and such is in there for the day is scheduling, I mean, most of my days are fairly full too, full up, you know, 3 to 5 days in advance in a lot of cases. Sometimes it's hard to tell people in the office, you know, the people that you work with, just send me an email, you know, so it's recorded. Because a lot of times in passing, they'll tell you, hey, can you do this or do that? And, you know, you forget about it. And then they did tell you, you remember this later, but you might be a week behind. So it's a lot easier to have them, you know, with the accountability factor, just, you know, sit down and actually send you that email saying, hey, Scott, I need you to place an ad here or there, or need to put a job posting out, or I need to throw something on BizMan or something. And just a lot easier if you have that trackability through that email. So I appreciate you mentioning that.
Yeah. You know, I love that, Scott. One of the tools that I found out in Outlook that changed my world, honestly, is the ability to drag an email to my calendar. And so if somebody sent me an email that said, oh, let's meet on Tuesday, you and I traded some emails back and forth and said, hey, let's have a call on Tuesday at 2. And I said, okay, well, I drug that email to my calendar and put that in as a calendar event. So I had, everything that we had talked about in trading our emails back and forth, but I didn't have to type in a calendar event. It just automatically, I drug it over to that. And that was a game changer for me. It's really made me more efficient and kept me from dropping the ball on things like that.
Absolutely. We've got a couple of minutes here. Do you guys have anything you want to throw in the box, or anybody want to be unmuted or unmute themselves to maybe shed a little bit more light on what we've talked about today?
Yeah, so while people are thinking about that, I, you know, wanted to mention again, I shared this yesterday, and I think, Scott, you may have sent an email out to everybody with the link. I have created a landing page specifically for ABC Seamless that provides a little bit more background information about, primarily about the things we talked about yesterday in the goal setting, and there's an opportunity to request some resources there as well. The other thing that was mentioned at the end of the call yesterday, and I want to mention again, is I'm glad to have a phone conversation with anybody as part of this. It's a free, no obligation, just an introductory phone conversation. And if you want to schedule something with me, and again, my trusted system is my calendar. On the website is a link where you can go ahead and go right to my calendar and schedule that meeting. And I'd love to do that. And I've got a lot of openings through the rest of this month and into January. And would be glad to chat with anybody that would like to talk about, you know, really anything about your business, but goals related, or, you know, maybe you've got a system that you're using and you're wondering about how to, you know, maybe how you can make it more effective. Sometimes a third party can really help help with that. And I'd be glad to do it.
I would just add one thing when it comes to organization is you have to, this is Troy in Eau Claire. You have to make the system yours. So everybody's a little bit different in what works and what doesn't work. A lot of times it's good to find out what some other people do and take bits and pieces and customize it to what works for you. Sounds simple, but don't try to take somebody that is disorganized and have them replicate your system, because it probably won't work as good for them.
You know, that Troy, I really appreciate you saying that. That's an excellent point. Really, that's what I hope that that's what came out of this today is these are my trusted systems and they work for me. And, you know, any part of it that, you know, you might look at and say, hey, that'll help me if I try that. And I may tweak it a little bit to fit me. But you're exactly right. It has to be your trusted system. Exactly. I really appreciate you bringing that out. And Brandon put a note in the chat, you know, for him having a paper planner and a digital calendar works really good for him. And again, I love the word, he keeps it simple. And Diana uses a calendar and journal format as well. The fact that I do that validates her use of that as well. Whatever works for you is the best. I think Troy said it best. You know, find what works for you. You know, when I first started to put this presentation together, I it was one of those things I thought, well, why? What am I doing telling people how to do these things? And what I found is there are so many people out there that had a lot of questions and really didn't know where to start. And so I thought, you know, let's go ahead and throw this out there, because for somebody that's struggling a little bit, this may give them a place to start, and then they can begin to tweak it and make it their own. So hopefully that's helped somebody this morning.
Right. Just to build off of what Troy said too, a big thing that happens is we all come up with these ideas. We're going to do this. We're going to be organized here. You have to really commit to it. a lot of times it falls by the wayside where people say, I'm going to use this day planner and everything's going in there. And for that first 3-4 days, everything's going in there. And then we get sidetracked and by everything going on in the world and whatnot. So that's the hardest part about it, is getting so committed to it that it does become just a daily routine to where it doesn't feel like anything's going on. It's just natural part of your day.
And yeah, to add on to that, Chris, too, is as you discover things that don't work as good as you thought they would, adjust your plan or adjust your system. Know that it's kind of a living document of how you stay organized, and eventually you'll land on something that really works for you.
Yeah, you know, that's exactly right. And Chris, you're dead on. You know, one of the hardest things for people is to establish new habits. I mean, that's what this is all about. It's about establishing new habits. We can have the best idea in the world, but if we don't implement it and establish it as a habit and a routine, which most habits take, you know, the experts say anywhere between 60 and 75 days for it to become a habit. And that's really where a mentor, a friend, accountability partner, a coach can really come in to help hold your feet to the fire, so to speak, to keep you on task. And to help you tweak it, again, as Troy indicated, to help you tweak it to fit with the way you know, operate your day and how you do business. Really great comments. Appreciate that, guys.
The one thing, and I don't know if you guys can hear me or not, but...
Yeah, we can.
The one thing I thought that was kind of unique, and I'm big in trying to make everything digital, and I've been trying to kind of go to that way, and then trying to find kind of a, and this was a conversation that Scott and I had, is just having one place where you communicate, you know, and that's really a big thing as far as a place that can combine those notes that you got to take every single day. But then the thing that I like that you said, was something about, you know, how you have a planner and a calendar, and that's kind of a, you know, two different things that when you said it made me realize how important that is too, because you have to have something that plans out your day individually. And for a lot of people, writing it down in a journal and stuff, you know, that, or, you know, in an actual day planner is big. But then having that digital calendar, and it keeps everyone else informed. That's what I think that, you know, the best use of going digital is, and having that capability. So everyone knows what you're doing, but it doesn't really, they don't really know how you're planning your day. That's what the planner's for, you know?
Yeah. You know, I mean, again, technology, and this is why I use a digital calendar now, is technology is so good where we can invite people to our calendar events, and it just keeps everybody in the know. I do that with all my coaching clients, is when we set a calendar event up, I invite them to that. And if we need to adjust that, if I move it on my calendar, it's moved on their calendar. And so we don't miss meetings now like we used to in the old days. So technology is really key, but I do like the old school stuff as well.
Yeah, just to touch on the point Brandon just brought up, is the technology will allow you to share calendars. I mean, pretty much everybody in our office, well, we all do use Outlook, and that'll display for our team that sets appointments. That'll show for the sales guys what they're doing on any given day. And we can put whatever information we want on there so they can mark themselves out or busy or doing something or set their own appointments and give us the information. And the office, you know, the front desk receptionist area, they can see that calendar too. So it's just, it communicates across all departments to let people know what your day looks like by sharing your business schedule. So that's really cool way to do it. And we've been doing that for probably since about 2010. So we've been doing that for a while. Seems to be working pretty damn well though.
Good. That's great. You know, the key in that, again, really is to fully engage in that system. We had problems with our team. We had a couple of key players, team leaders, that decided they didn't want to play nice in the sandbox, and they wouldn't share their calendars. Well, I, you know, if one of my underlings, you know, didn't want to show their calendar, I would just say, hey, you know what, you're a deadbeat. It's, I wouldn't say that, but, I might, but I deal with it. But when it was one of my team leaders, man, it really upset the apple cart, and we had to correct that. That was a big deal. And what we had to show him was the benefits, and how it would benefit him and make him more efficient. And we were able to do that. But good stuff. Well, again, my offer stands. If anybody wants to talk further about these types of things and, you know, maybe wants a little bit of help, maybe tweaking their systems a little bit, go ahead and go to my website, sign up for a meeting time. We'll just have a meeting. And again, there's no obligation beyond that. I just love helping people. And so I'd be glad to do it.
Yep. And I did send that email out to everybody. So if you didn't get it, just email media@abcseamless.com and we'll get that information out to you. Okay. Cool. Tom, it's been a pleasure. I appreciate you being part of the first 2020 Zoom conference over at ABC Seamless, and really enjoyed having you. And that is the round of applause that typically is a little bit louder, but we all appreciate it. I know we do. So
thank you, Scott and Ted, and your gang there. Special thanks to Diana for making the connection for me. I love doing this kind of stuff, and Scott, we'll be in communication. I'd love to help you guys out where I can in the future as well.
That sounds great. Thank you, sir.
Awesome. And,
on that note, I'm going to bring up, Brian Behan. Everybody should have a good idea of who this gentleman is, by now. And, he's been with, Socius for, well, it's been a long time, and, we connected first off through Ted as well. That's an interesting thing back in, was it 2012? I think you made the first connection, right? Brian, are you down there? I just got to unmute you.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yep. We got it.
Awesome. Yeah. I think 2012 is when you and I started working together, and then Ted probably around 2010, because I met him through Timo.
Fantastic. And today, it says senior internet marketing consultant now. Senior, does that mean you're a little older than, you know, a few people now?
Yeah, getting up there.
But today you're going to
Somehow 30 years have slipped by. Let's leave it at that.
That's crazy. We know you very well. We trust you in Fargo and a lot of different locations, do business with you. You've got some good information today that I think a few people will, they'll be surprised at some of the information you're sharing, but right now I'm going to hand it off to you because we're a little bit behind schedule. So don't worry about going over just a little bit too, okay?
Okay, I appreciate it. Are you able to see the screen, Scott?
Yes, we can. Thanks, Brian.
Fantastic. Well, hello, everybody, and glad to be here and share some exciting information with everybody on some online lead generation opportunities we've really never discussed before. Always try to bring fresh, relevant information to the ABC Seamless Network. For those of you that might not be very familiar with Socius, just a little bit of information about us. We're based out of Tampa, Florida. That was our office when we all used to go to the office. Hopefully someday we'll get back there. We've been in business since 2006. We're the largest digital marketing company that focuses in on working with home remodelers. Throughout the country, we've literally worked with thousands and thousands of home remodelers. This really makes us an expert in online lead generation and digital marketing within your marketing space. I think, you know, most of the network is familiar with the work that Socius does with website designs and search engine optimization. I think it's important, you know, I always like to remind everybody, we're a full service agency. So in addition to being able to help you with website design and certainly search engine optimization and content production, we have a full digital media department where we manage lots of very successful Google ad campaigns, which is something that we're going to talk about today. Lots of successful Facebook ad campaigns, which hopefully somewhere down the line we'll get to talk to you about. And then through that department, we also manage lots of social media platforms for our clients. You know, we do different kinds of designs, and I'm going to be rolling out an opportunity here today for everybody. But when we build a design, it's about generating leads. We're really experts in, you know, online lead generation. That's what we're studying all the time through web conversion analytics. You know, I've been in your space since 2006, so almost 15 years. And, you know, I understand the business. I understand how important your online reputation is and how important that is to any sales that you're going to do and any leads you're going to get through your website. So we have some very robust reputation management software. So if any of you have issues getting reviews or anything like that, please reach out to me. I mean, these are things that we can help you with. You know, one of the things I'm very proud of is Socius is a client-side company. Everything that we develop for you guys, or anybody for that matter, you own. So any website design or design work we do, our clients own. Any content we produce, you own. Any search engine optimization that we do, you own. Believe it or not, that's not always the case. And that's why I'm pointing that out. You really want to look for what's called a client-side company. We're really excited about the agenda today. I got some fresh information to share. It's been an interesting year. You know, it's certainly been very challenging, but there's also been historic online opportunity. You know, there's a lot of reasons for that. We could talk about them for a long time, but I'm just going to share some information just on the historic opportunity that's happened online over the summertime. In fact, many of our clients have set records. I'm going to share some information on how much of your overall budget you want to dedicate towards marketing, and specifically the digital marketing channel. You know, back in late July, Scott and I got together a Google ad campaign for ABC Seamless Fargo. So we're going to talk about that campaign. It was very successful. It's really the best way to target the historic opportunity we're seeing online in terms of the surge in search traffic, because Google Ads will get you up there right away, as opposed to SEO. SEO is great, but unless you are already doing a SEO successfully, you likely were not very successful in going after that historic opportunity we saw over the summer. I'm going to go over the continued opportunity everybody has to optimize the corporate website. I think that's something that we forget about. There's a lot of leads that come out of that website. I think a lot of people would be surprised, you know, how many leads have come out of that website year to date. I'll share that. You know, with a lot of folks setting records, it's really become a challenge. Now, all of those sales that were done, you know, they have to be installed. And to find good installation crews, good talent there from many of our clients is rough. So we're going to review the ABC Seamless job site that was built out in 2019 and just remind everybody of that opportunity. The last thing we're going to leave off with is what's new for 2021. We got together with ABC Seamless Corporate, and we have modified the Socius theme to include the design tool and the color swatch tool. So I'm going to share with you that opportunity and what that looks like. So pretty aggressive and exciting agenda. I'm going to jump in. I see people are chatting me. If you want to just hold on maybe to the end, if we have some time, like Scott says we have some time, I can definitely answer any questions that might come in. These next few slides that I'm going to share with everybody come from Google Trends. And Google Trends allows us to input a keyword such as siding and let us know what the search volume looks like over time. And this is a 5-year look back. And you can see certainly over time, the search volume has grown. But I think what is important to point out is you know, this is when the pandemic hit, right in here. This is where COVID hit. And you see right after COVID hit, we're all locked up in our house. We're all tied to our computers. Search volume is an all-time high. Never been that high in the past 5 years. Sure, it's never been that high, period, and for that matter. And that's true for all of the core keywords that we would want to rank on within the business that, you know, most folks on this line are in. You know, roofing, gutters, siding. Gutters, all-time high over the summer. And then roofing also hit an all-time high over the summer. So the question becomes, you know, how much do you want to be earmarking to go after this online opportunity? I pulled this earlier in the year. This comes from the U.S. Small Business Administration, and it suggests that you spend 7-8% of your gross revenue on marketing, and that 50% of that should be spent on the digital channel in 2020 and beyond. In fact, you're probably going to assume that over time that split would go up over time, because it's already gone up. I've watched it go up over time. That's just how important this channel is in this day and age that we're in. So as I mentioned, the best way to access this opportunity quickly, because we can get a Google Ads campaign up in a matter of weeks and start generating leads, is through a Google Ads campaign. So we're going to talk about the keys to targeting that campaign and the keys to running a successful Google Ads campaign, basically what to look like if you look for if you were going to hire a company like Socius. Just so that we're all on the same page, when we're talking about Google Ads or paid ads or PPC, they're all the same thing. And we're talking about doing a campaign where we're showing up in this space right here where it says ad. As you can see, it's at the top of the search page. There are a lot of leads that happen here. This is a marketing expenditure. ABC Seamless Fargo is paying for every click here. So it's important that everything be measured as a marketing expenditure. So here's some keys to success, whether you know you're running it internally or you're looking to hire a company, just some information to share with you. And then I'll share with you some results from the pilot program. You know, you don't hire an agency like Socius to make the campaign work better over time. And there's certain things that we can affect as an agency and certain things we cannot. For example, we can't change what Google charges for a click for a given keyword in a given marketing area, obviously, right? But we can react to the data that we're seeing within the campaign and then make changes to the campaign based on that data. That's something that we can control. The other thing that we can control is we can control where we're landing that traffic. And that's a big factor because by where we land the traffic, we can significantly impact the conversion rate, click to lead. And we've done a lot of A/B testing in and around landing environments, and I'll share some of that with you and show you what we did for ABC Seamless and what you all can use, what's available to you now. Complete transparency is very important if you're gonna work with an outside agency managing your campaign. It's very important that you know where all of your money goes. And the only way that you can know where all of your money goes is if you're paying the search engine directly, the entire budget. That means you've got a credit card up with Google and you're paying Google directly for all of the clicks as they accrue. That's the only way you can be sure where all of your money is going. You also want to make sure you have your own login to your own account so that you can see what the company is buying and make sure that they're not spending too much money leveraging your brand online. It's important to protect your brand online, but you don't want someone abusing your brand online either. You want to work with an agency that's not just concerned with providing you leads at a great cost per lead. It goes beyond that. I've seen it. We can produce leads at a great cost per lead, but if the client is ill-prepared to receive those leads and issue those leads, it's not going to work. It's about a marketing cost. It's not about a cost per lead. So we actually like to do a phone call prior to launching any Google Ads campaign where we pull in the client's call center and let them know what to expect when the ads are turned on, what products we're targeting, if we're targeting competitors, what competitors we're targeting, whether or not inbound phone scripts might be needed. We have great phone scripts that Tony Hody provided us. I really consider him, and many in the industry consider him, one of the best in generating and issuing viable leads. You know, there's a lot of companies out there these days that aren't made up of people. It seems like software manages a lot of things for most internet marketing agencies. And Socius Marketing, even though we don't get to go to that office every day, we're still a company of nearly 100 employees. We do everything in-house, and we don't use software to manage AdWords campaigns. We provide our clients their own Google AdWords certified specialists that will make adjustments to the campaign based on the data within the campaign, you know, manage those nuances that we see. It's very important, you know, again, this is a marketing expenditure. It's not like SEO where you own the content that we're producing for you each month. When you're doing Google Ads or any such marketing expenditure, it's important to come together each month and not only talk about how much was spent and how many leads, but talk about the quality. Talk about what was issued, demoed, and sold so that we can proactively calculate a marketing cost. One of the great things about Google Ads is it's scalable. If you need more leads, most of the time you could just spend more money. So getting that correct marketing cost is very important so that you can scale your business. I mentioned the A/B testing. We did a lot of A/B testing with some of our very large home remodelers back 2 years now, I guess it was. And the budgets that our clients had allowed us to try different landing environments. It allowed us to do A/B testing on the landing environment. And we went through a series of tests where we landed the paid traffic into main pages of the main website. Then we tried landing the paid traffic into single page landing pages. And then finally, we tried these product-centric microsites that we developed. They're 4 or 5 pages in scope, and they only speak about the products that we're doing the Google Ad campaign for. And really, these convert better really for two reasons. It's twofold. First of all, if I'm searching for insulation, if I'm searching for siding, and I go to Google and I do a search for siding, and I land here on this microsite, ABC Seamless looks like an expert on what I'm online searching for, siding. I know it says insulation there, but that's only if you're buying new siding. Secondly, it really keeps me on the path to conversion because it doesn't show me anything else. I went online looking for siding by not showing me anything else but other than siding. They're keeping me on the path to conversion, focused in on what I was looking for. So we're landing all of the siding keywords that we're buying into this siding microsite. All of the replacement windows keywords, we're landing into this replacement windows website. And finally, all of the roofing keywords that we're buying, we're landing into this roofing microsite. These microsites outperform anything else that we tried 3-1. That's a fantastic way to really impact the conversion rate, which is the best way to impact the cost per lead. So ABC Seamless Corporate, they made the initial investment in these microsites. So as long as you guys are doing business as ABC Seamless, these could be applied to a campaign that Socius managed for you and built for you for just $300 each, since that initial investment was made by ABC Seamless. If anyone's interested in this, at the end of the call, I'll have my information up. We actually generate our budgets directly from Google, and I would just need to get some basic information from you in terms of what products you would want to focus on, where you would want to see your ad show up. And just like we did with Scott, we'll go through an exercise where after we get some key performance indicators from you, we'll back our way into a potential lead cost and a potential marketing cost to see how feasible it is for you and your business. This is a marketing expenditure, so you definitely want to track the conversions. One of the great things about the microsites is that it gives us that different landing environment. It's rather easy to parse out the traffic and the leads that way. You want to track the calls that come in from something called ad extensions, which are phone numbers that show up in Google Ads. You want to track the phone calls that come into the microsite. We use call tracking and look forward to any phone number that you would want it to. And then obviously the forms that people fill out on that microsite. We track these over 90 days. You want to track them every 30 days, obviously, but we track them every 90 days, 30, 60, and 90 days. So this is a 90-day look back, actually, for the campaign that we have done for ABC Fargo. This was the pilot program and the results of the initial 90 days. You can see here in August, we generated 77 leads. In September, we generated 90 leads. In October, we started experiencing some seasonality because of the chilly weather and got 65 leads. We launched the very back end of July. We're reporting each month to Scott the number of clicks, the number of impressions, the click-through rate, the cost per click, how much the client is spending, the impression share, the number of forms, the number of calls, the total conversions, and then the conversion rate, which is super important. The conversion rate is what percentage of the people that are clicking into the microsite are giving you their phone number or their form lead, and that's what we're always trying to impact. And then the cost per conversion. You can see down here, we spent just short of $9,300. We generated 232 leads at a lead cost of $39.98. I mean, you could triple that lead cost and that would still be a good lead cost in most instances. So the program was very successful. We're happy to roll this out to everybody. Again, the initial investment in the microsites was made by ABC Seamless. So you can get into those microsites just for $300 each should you move forward with something like this. We're gonna switch gears and talk about how to get more leads out of the abcseamless.com website. There's been over 3,000 form leads that have come in year to date, excluding sweepstakes leads, because there's been thousands more of those, but I took those out because those are very top of the funnel leads, and excluding any paid leads that I just showed you. So there's been over 3,000 forms that have come in that don't fall under sweepstakes or paid. If you're not getting your fair share, there's probably a reason why. I want to review with everybody the opportunities that everybody has to add local SEO pages to the ABC Seamless corporate website. This is the top of the homepage of the ABC Seamless corporate website. If you ever want to know where the local SEO is and whether or not there's any local SEO on this website that you put on this website, this is how you would find out. It's quite easy. Just go to the website, scroll to the bottom of the homepage, and you'll see a link right here that says areas served. That's where all the local SEO lives. You click that link, you're going to arrive at an interior page that looks like this one right here. And it lists out, as you can see, all of the states that ABC Seamless has franchises in. And what you would want to do is simply just click into the state that you're located in. I just clicked into Minnesota and landed here. And these are all of the different cities that we've done SEO pages for, all of these different cities. And if I wanted to see how many pages we did for Detroit Lakes, I'd click in Detroit Lakes, and there would be all of the different SEO articles that we wrote for Detroit Lakes. If you do not see your cities located, that means that there's no local SEO on this website for you. And that's likely why you're not getting a lot of leads. This opportunity was rolled out, 4 or 5 years ago. And I think it's just one of those deals where people simply just forget. But again, everyone's got that opportunity to add pages to the corporate website. And it's important to understand what we're doing when we're adding these pages. We're adding pages with great purpose. So for example, in Fargo, if we want to rank on home siding Fargo, we're going to write a page that's going to work with great purpose on home siding Fargo. And that's how we're going to compete at a very high level on that very specific search. It's called building the pages with purpose. So when you think about your own area and the opportunity to add local SEO pages to this website that will generate you leads, because remember, anyone that fills out a form on the corporate website that comes from your area, you get those forms directly. They don't go to Scott and then forward it to you. They go right over to you directly. So if there's 10 keywords that you want to rank on that are you consider very, very important, and then 10 cities or towns that you would want to rank in, you know, over time, you would want to develop 100 individual pages and get them up on this website that are optimized for your area in that fashion. If you did this, you would get an impactful amount of leads. Now, I'm not suggesting that you do this all at once. That's probably not very feasible for most folks. But if you added 4 pages a quarter or 10 pages a quarter, you'd get there eventually. If you add 10 pages a quarter, that's 40 pages a year. 2 years, you're pretty much where you want to be. Promise you, this would be an impactful investment. Once we get these pages up, they stay up, and they generally will stay up on the first page, like what I like to call evergreen. So the key to getting optimized pages on this website is this insertion order form. Scott has this form and I have this form. If you're interested, just get this form out to us. Just request this form and we will go ahead and get this form over to you. And then I will help you fill it out. If you just fill out the top portion here, we could talk about what keywords and what makes sense for you. And I'll help you with the rest of it. But this is the key. Whenever you want to add local SEO pages to the site, just reach out to Scott or I, and we can help you with that. I'm going to talk about how to help you guys recruit good talent. I mean, with everybody setting sales records earlier in the year, now there's a very common problem of, you know, people have a backlog of jobs that need to be installed, and they're having difficulty finding quality installers, quality employees, period, in many quick cases. But I hear quality installers very, very often. So I want to remind everybody that in 2019, we built this website, this abcseamlessjobs.com website. It's a separate website that was built out to help not only Fargo recruit, but the whole network recruit. If you want to get to this website, just go to the abcseamless.com website. At the very top navigation, you'll see a link for careers. Click careers, and you'll land here on this website that we built out. This website clearly displays the benefits and the culture and the positions that are available at ABC Seamless. It's meant to differentiate you among your competitors. So here are some advantages to this site that I want to remind everybody about. It reaches potential candidates beyond your local reach. There's a lot of people that, you know, will move for a job. So if you can post your job to an area, you know, where your competitors cannot, you can pull people in where your competitors are not advertising. So an excellent opportunity to display culture and opportunity for advancement as part of a national brand. Again, it's about differentiating yourself. As I mentioned, you know, you can advertise job openings where your competitors cannot, because they definitely cannot post their job openings on this site. And there's no cost to this, which just makes it, to me, just a big no-brainer. So any job that you post, why would you not post it on the on this website? So what you want to do is you just want to go ahead and you want to post, you want to contact media at abcseamless.com, and they will help you get any job openings that you have up. And once they're filled, they can pull them down for you as well. So the last thing that we're going to talk about, then hopefully we got some time for some questions, because I saw I'm getting a lot of chatter there. Hopefully we can get to some of those questions. You know, a lot of this is new for 2021 that I've discussed, but this is something that entirely new that we just developed here. And that's the opportunity to get into a Socius theme that has been modified for the ABC Seamless franchises. What we've got here is Scott and I got together, and ABC Seamless Corporate has made an investment in modifying the Socius theme. And what we've done is we've built in the color swatch and the design tool, and we've baked it into this social, to this existing Socius theme that we have here. So what's included in this theme, as I mentioned, is the ABC design tool has been incorporated into it, and the siding swatches tool has been incorporated into it. And ABC Seamless Corporate has paid for this adaptation of this theme. So that's already been done for you. This website design is beyond responsive. It's what we call mobile first. It allows for a deep scroll down the page. That's the new norm now. Most of us that are searching from our mobile devices, you know, we take our thumb or our forefinger and we scroll down and we scroll down and we scroll down to consume information. It features the lazy loading content as they scroll down, and it features what's called product locators that allows people to consume additional information about your products without having to load a new page. Makes it very, very mobile friendly. We also feature an app-based experience on our themes. So if you look at the way this mobile experience is here, as someone would take their finger and scroll down, or their thumb and scroll down, this get a price and this our services is ever present. It's very much like an app that you would see when you visit any other site. Very, very intuitive way to display on a mobile site. So as I mentioned, ABC Seamless paid for the incorporation of those tools into the existing Socius theme. The Socius theme can be used by any ABC Seamless franchise. Forgive me, that says dealer. I just noticed that now. I wish I would have caught that. I definitely understand the difference. But this can be used by any ABC Seamless franchise doing business as ABC Seamless franchise for a one-time fee of $4,425. It's available to existing Socius clients that are active with Socius, or any new Socius clients with any SEO package or qualifying marketing package that we're doing. For most of you, you're in a WordPress website. So if we were to move the over to this website, it's just a $350 fee for that page move if you are in WordPress. So just to kind of go over some of the opportunities we talked about today, we talked about the Google Ads, the best way to get up and running and going after that super search volume that we're seeing. If you're interested in doing that, we would just need to get together and do a brief call, discuss the products you want to target, the areas you want to target. I'll get some key performance indicators. We can have that conversation. Secondly, you know, the opportunity to add SEO pages to that corporate website and get additional leads coming in. And lastly, if you're interested in a new design, we have a fantastic opportunity for you to move in, just an awesome design featuring those design and the swatch tools for you. Scott, that's what I had for everybody today. I did see quite a bit of chats coming in. I didn't know if we had time for any questions or if we needed to move on.
Yeah, we do. A lot of them have been wanting to request that form that you showed for that 255 for SEO pages built on our site. So if you could resend that to me to make sure I have it, I'll make sure to get it out to everybody on the call.
Sure.
With that,
or they can do that. I'll do that, or they can email me directly as well. I'll do both.
Sure. You guys can do either or. If you email me, it's media at abcseamless.com or Brian direct. Either one works just fine. We want to make sure that you guys get that information so you can use that to your advantage on setting up your goals and your strategy for 2021 going on. And that was really nice. It was a really fast way to go through everything that we've done in the last few years. So very good job. I'm just going to tell you that, you know, we talk a lot, but you know, I sat there for half an hour and paid attention the whole damn time. And we've been through this a lot. So it was really good, Brian, really good information. Does anybody have any questions? Any questions you want to get unmuted quickly and talk to Brian directly, throw something in the chat box. We can relay it over to him. Someone said that they did forget about the page option. And a lot of people do. They get busy with their own workloads in December, you know, December, January, February, typically the slower months for us. And probably a lot of you guys on the call as well. But this is the time where you basically sit down and figure out your strategy. And if you're not doing digital stuff, that's kind of the reason why Brian's on here is, you should be building pages out. I know some of you guys have used Keyword Connects in the past. They're going through a lot of changes and really disappointed us on their transparency on their Google campaigns. So that's why it just made sense to go with someone that we know and trust, been working with for 10 years, Socius Marketing, and really the relationship is very strong. So these are who we recommend at corporate, and I know Ted Wood as well over at his stores, and a lot of you guys already are partners with Socius, but I just want to relay, hey guys, take a look at this, build some pages, get yourself stronger, because your website stronger, that makes our ABC Seamless website stronger and vice versa. And you know, it's just fantastic getting all that information out there online. And that's how people look for you nowadays. And I think, Brian, I think you said 50% of your budget should go towards digital to some degree nowadays.
That's not what I said. That's
well, you said it,
eminently yeah, more qualified than me.
I gotcha. If there aren't any questions, Brian, this information.
There might be a couple of questions. Anybody have any questions? Nope. Okay.
I'd like to make a comment really quick. I guess for any of you that are kind of on the fence on where you should be spending your marketing dollars, I think this is a great opportunity. The reason why I like, you know, utilizing these Google ads is because what you can measure can be managed. So when you're spending this money online, you actually know where you're spending and what these leads are actually going to cost you versus advertising on TV or on radio or whatever the case might be. And obviously with, you know, everything going on currently, I mean, obviously more people are sitting at home on their phones, you know, go online looking for siding. You're going to be the first thing that pops up on there. So I would highly recommend looking at doing some kind of a Google campaign if you aren't already.
Great points, Grant. Thank you.
I don't see anything else coming up, but they can call you directly on your cell or email you, ask you any questions. You'd be happy to set aside one-on-ones.
Yep.
And definitely. Thanks for
the reminder. I mean, if it's just a call about the paid side of things, it can be a 15-minute call. I did want to also remind if anyone as part of the network wants a free website evaluation and a free benchmark of how the website is ranking, we can also put together an evaluation of your citation work in terms of all of your local listings and consistency within your local listings. And take a look at your reputation management. I just want to remind everybody that's part of, you know, why you're part of this franchise group, so that you can have access to, you know, companies like Socius. So please take advantage of it. I feel like I don't hear from as many of you as I used to. So I would welcome any calls about anything you'd like to talk about.
Perfect, Brian.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you for your time today. Bye-bye. Fantastic. And then now we're going to welcome up Mark Hybaugh, who is the developer of this company, Marlimar Mobile Strategies, as well as Chris Merrifield. And they've got a lot of good information to show you on automation and how to communicate out to potential clients, if you will, and existing and potential and new and anybody that comes in the system. I'm going to hand it off to you right now because we're about 10 minutes behind schedule. Mark and Chris, thank you guys for joining us this morning.
Thanks, Scott. Is my screen visible?
Yep, you're good to go.
You can see my screen, great. All right, guys, thanks for having us. And we're here to talk about text message communication. And it's critically important today to have a concierge level of communication to your homeowners. And I know that you all are doing different strategies and you probably all know the importance of text messaging today. But I just wanna point out that even the starting photo shows how important sending the right message means. It used to be just a year or two ago that people would have that phone up to their ear because they'd be talking on the phone. Today, people are looking at their phone more, looking at videos, looking at social media and text messaging. But what I want to do is go through here and talk a little bit about why companies need to use text messaging more effectively. You all probably know these stats, but let's just look at a few of the stats. 50% of calls now that go out across the country are unwanted. Last year, they calculated those to be 4 billion spam calls a year. And I don't know about you guys, but I'm getting phone calls from my own area code and from all over the world that I choose not to answer because I don't know who they are. And unless it's in my address book, I'm likely not to answer the call. You guys, I'm sure, are quite the same when it comes to answering that. And I'm sure we still get too many unwanted spam phone calls. I hear from companies, though, we know that, don't bother me with that stat, but they'll answer. We leave a voicemail and they'll answer their voicemail. They listen to it. Well, the same stat a year ago said that only 14% of people are listening to their voicemails. So that's still an ineffective way to communicate. Conversely speaking, Pew Research did a study 3 years ago that showed 95% of text messages are read in the first 3 minutes of delivery. And they argue that almost every text message is eventually read. So that is a more effective way to communicate. And we have companies today now that are sending text messages in replacement of a phone call and email. People today view text communication as talking, which is a very strange phenomenon to me because I didn't grow up that way. However, people view that as an effective way to communicate. But we've got companies that will want to send a text message out every time an email goes out and just bury people with text messages now. Well, our company has learned that if you're going to get a response from a homeowner, you must only send them the critical information they need. And there are several components to that information. It must be timely. It must be perceived as valuable, not with an offer, but valuable to them in conveying relevant information. And just like this woman with her ears over or her hands over her ears, if you send text messages for the very same way that you send email, you're likely to get that very same result. So what we want to do is help companies communicate in a different manner, in a concierge level of communication, so that your homeowners will appreciate the communications they get. They know that they're not going to get berated with text message over and over and over again. And hopefully they'll feel more likely to respond to the messaging they get. In asking a lot of companies to ask their customers what they want, their customers want personal interaction. They want less messaging, but more relevant information. And they want to have two-way conversations, as mentioned earlier. And more than that, you want a company that knows and understands the risks of sending unwanted information to homeowners, especially illegal type of information through text messaging when it's not under consent. That really raises some questions. Are you text messaging in a consent manner? So that's what our company focuses on, is delivering an approach to your homeowners in a way that they will not only appreciate, but will keep you out of legal issues ever. And so our method of doing it is quite different than most companies. Not only do we connect to software to automate messaging out, which is critically important, and we're doing that for Scott right now and many other companies across the country, but we have to do it in such a manner that the people recognize it's coming from you, your company. So we send it from your callback landline numbers. So now you get a lead in and your team calls that lead out immediately and no one answers because they don't recognize your number. And now immediately a text message goes out, either automatically or manually, that says, hi, Scott, this is Mark with ABC Seamless. You just request information. I tried calling you and you didn't answer. I can help you and answer your questions. So either call me back or let me know a good time to call you. That's a personal conversation. That's a relevant message to what's going on. And these people are likely to reply back. Also, we feel it's critically important not just to send it from that callback landline number, but to also include pictures and images with that. And I tell you what, this other stuff's important. The two-way conversations, the messaging with name, and engaging with variable messages, which we do all of that. But what's most important is doing it in an automated manner and add not just a concierge level to your homeowners, but productivity to you all. And that's what we will do with whatever software you have available. We get reported back often from companies as to what has it done to them. And of course, you know, there's the to set rate, and then there's this their confirmation to demo rate. And you add those rates together. And I'm not going to go through that, but we've been told repeatedly that our approach will give you between a 10 to 15% increase on both. So it will add productivity to you. Even on the production side, we hear regularly that people have, companies have a hard time communicating with their homeowners already purchased because they're not answering their phone calls. Through text messaging, you can accomplish that very same thing and even get the responses back and have that conversation via text. So what I want to show you is what this looks like. This is using ABC's corporate dashboard, and we can send messages out with a logo that speaks to you in person. This is me. And it comes from, if you notice the phone number up at top, it comes from a 701 area code, which is the number that ABC Seamless is using. And it's the same phone number that's asked to reply back. Furthermore, through this dashboard, you can receive a message back and it will show you that that message has been sent back. But not only can they send a text message back, they can send a text message with a picture of what they're dealing with. Here's what I want to replace with a crappy picture of some siding. So now you see the job that you're dealing with. You can speak to them upfront about it. And this picture is not only showing up on a web dashboard, but it is also available for immediate reporting and is delivered via email to whoever you need to deliver it to. And of course, you can also text back to them. Matter of fact, most companies we work with are delivering reminder messages, but reminder messages with pictures of not just of the appointment coming up, but pictures of the sales reps that are coming out to the house. And that adds an extra level of safety. And of course, here's a great picture of Scott. I think this was taken last month, if I'm not mistaken. Is that right, Scott?
Oh my gosh, that's crazy. That's pretty much when I just started. So that would have been 2009 or 10.
So as a rep, Scott can have his picture sent out. And so it says, for your comfort and protection, a picture of Scott is attached. So it's critically important to not just send a text message. That will get you nowhere. Let's send messaging that will get the responses you want. And that's the please customers by sending it from your callback landline number and with pictures and encouraging them to send pictures back. So, Chris, are you on the line?
Yep, I'm here.
All right, great. So I have Chris here to help field some questions and see what other questions you all may have. I wanted to make this short and concise to give you a chance to ask us any questions that you may have. Scott can get you information about us, and we are in every state. We know the laws of consent for every single state, and I've been privileged in being asked for other companies to serve as expert witnesses in class action lawsuits. So I know what consent messaging is all about, and our company is all about not just following the legal manners of messaging, but doing it in a way that's best practices for your homeowners that will get the responses that they want and that you ultimately want. So I guess, Scott, I purposely made this short and I wanted to open this up for questions and see what things you'd like to add. And I'm going to actually turn it over to Chris, if you don't mind, Scott, because I'm in another all-day meeting.
Yep, no problem at all. I appreciate you being on the call here. And I don't know how long you worked on me to get this going in the first place, but I remember us over drinks a few different conferences that finally pulled the trigger, and very happy to pull it. you know, it's really reasonable cost comparative to any other system that's out there. And also the API integration with MarketSharp is very strong. So I'm going to hand it over to Chris as well, and he's going to talk on behalf of what we've got set up and the automation on our end. And I think it's valuable to at least take a look at a few of those things, and then we'll open it up to questions after that, if that's okay.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thanks, Mark. Appreciate it. Good seeing you.
All right. Well, welcome, everybody. I do want to talk briefly. So with Scott and ABC Seamless, we're connected to his MarketSharp, and we are in the process of, we've been sending sales appointment reminders for a long time for Scott, even from the old system before this one existed. We were Scott was the first actually to make us, to have us automate through MarketSharp sales appointment reminders. And so as you can see with that picture of Scott, we've been around for a while with him. And so yeah, currently—
let's take that off there, yeah.
here we go. I'll share mine instead. So this is their current dashboard. And then, so what we're doing with Scott, or in the process of getting ready to do, is we are going to send lead follow-up messaging. So once an inquiry comes in for MarketSharp, we're gonna send a message after X amount of time that he's chosen to send him a text message saying, hey, you've requested information. We've not been able to get in contact with you. We have the ability to automate the reminder messages like we talked about. We are turning on a thank you job sold message for him as well. If you're using MarketSharp on the production side, you know, we can do the measure appointments if you're doing them, the installs, we can do the automated kind of formula based messaging. So if the sold date is, 3 months to the estimated install date or something like that, you know, send a message once a week or whatever, we can automate those messages. And I will tell you that one of the things that you see an advantage in messaging the in-between is you all have the customers who you say it'll be 4 months or 6 months from purchase to install. And after 3 weeks, they start calling you going, hey, where are we at? If you start texting those people from this system, they'll start questioning you that via text. They'll ask for updates via text more than they'll ask via phone call. And so that's less time you have to spend on the phone because it takes just a moment or two to answer those. We can send out review request messaging where we first ask them to respond 1 to 5. And if they respond to 1, 2, or 3, we send them an apology type text message. If they send back a 4 or 5, we're sending them out, I think for Scott, to Google and Facebook, where they can leave a public review, but we're not sending that link to anybody who's not gonna give them at least 4 stars. And we get them straight to the Google page or the Facebook review page. So the Google one goes, if you're logged into Google, takes you straight to the stars. Again, the less clicks we see, the more, the more chance you have people of leaving it. The farther and the more you have to get them to click, the less chance you get of somebody actually leaving a review. We're also starting some demo no sale rehash reset kind of stuff also, where we're all automated, where we're reading from MarketSharp. And then we are posting back or will be soon. MarketSharp is finishing up this week. I think our ability to post back into the activity of the contact in MarketSharp. And so it'll be able to post that we have had incoming texts and outgoing texts and what those texts say. We have some competition out there who says that we cannot do certain things that they can do. And that's just not the case. There's not anything that anybody else can do that we aren't able to do as well. And even with Socius, we have a deal with Socius, or with one of their clients at least, that when a lead comes in, most of their leads come from their website. And so every time Socius alerts that company, Indianapolis-based company, it also alerts us and we send an automated text message. And so, you know, we can do that with some of the lead aggregators and stuff. And so especially, you know, these leads where speed matters, Home Advisor, Quinn Street, those kind of things, or even, your number one lead source, we can take it so that we get an alert the same time you do. And most of the time when that happens, that's happening so fast that the text actually beats your phone call, regardless of how quickly you're able to get on the phone with that person. And so, this is a great example here. Everybody assumes now in the United States that every number is textable. And so if you have your landline number out there somewhere and it's not textable, you're missing out, because this is what this is. So these are two schools. Somebody probably has the work phone number as the ABC seamless number. And so the school's trying every number on every contact to see if it's textable. And so, you know, this could very easily be someone, you know, who saw your phone number on your webpage or whatever and just had a quick question. And so they just text you that, because, you know, when you do a chat online, you have to sit there and stay there while you're chatting. Whereas if you go back and forth via text, you can kind of go about your day and kind of take your time responding and stuff. And so just some real advantages to the automation that we can provide, and to, you know, the landline and the conversation box go back and forth with customers. All right, Scott, I think that's essentially what I wanted to share.
Yeah, so anyone that isn't using an automation service texting, there's a lot of them out there. However, we've got a great relationship with Mark and Chris, like we said earlier. I mean, it's there are other platforms out there, right? But typically they're going to charge you an arm and a leg. I've seen a lot that are double this price that don't even do half of what this does. Now, they might look sometimes in cases they have more color to them than the color that's on the screen, but who cares about that? What we care about is making sure the automation gets done. And Chris has been very good about sending mass text out to customers. Our sales manager, Mike, sent one out the other day on behalf of a salesperson that's no longer working with us. We got, you know, four or five responses, sold another 12 to 20 grand just off of sending text messages out to customers. And here's the thing is, like, I would prefer a text too. I mean, I enjoy talking on the phone. I enjoy talking. However, it's just, if you're busy or on the phone, or you've got something on your mind, or you're with your kid or with your family, you'd rather just have a text, right? So why not this just be a reminder? Like, we've been using you guys since 2012, and it's been a long time. And just the communication part is just way different in the world that we live in now. So this part, Chris, I know we've talked about this before, but we'll probably put on another longer event to go through exactly how this works for anybody that's interested in taking a look at this. However, right now, does anybody have any specific questions for Chris while he's on the line? Chris, you've been here for close to 5 years now. Is that right?
I think three I've worked.
Okay. Well, you could have said five and we wouldn't have known even. So.
Yeah, I know, but I don't really like to lie.
Okay, no problem. Just text me and then it's not a lie. It's good.
Yeah.
anybody have any questions for Chris or anything that they want to see quickly? We're at, we're about noon here. These guys are great to work with. Very reachable. Anything you want to set up on your end in MarketSharp, just for example, you could set up your job charts with a month in there that'll automatically send that out whenever you prefer to. So you've got your jobs for the next 2 months in there. Let them know that the jobs will be done in the next couple months. Mass text all 50 at one time. I mean, that's a time savings of calling every single customer. You can always include your phone number in there to call. But I mean, if you're texting that information out, typically people aren't going to call. I mean, just nowadays, just in the showroom a couple of weeks ago, we had a 93-year-old that sent me photos from her cell phone. So now the world is just—it's just changed, and I think texting is the easiest way to do so. Chris, do you have any comments you'd like to add to end this baby up for this session, anyway?
No, not if there's not any questions. I know better than to go long at lunchtime. So
I got you.
I'm going to be respectful of lunch.
will you get me an email? I could send out everybody with your information to learn more. And then You and I will get together and try to put something together for maybe end of January, February time to let people know how many options there are available in here when we have some feedback behind them.
Yeah, absolutely.
Let's do that. Chris, thanks for your time here.
Yep. Thanks so much, Scott.
Appreciate it. Everybody out there, it's lunchtime. We do have one thing we'd like to do. You guys can jump off, but we're going to be talking about the ABC seamless family members that we've lost this last year. We haven't done that yet. And, I will share my screen here. Do-do-do. Chris, can you see the screen?
Yep.
All right. So what we want to do is we're going to send this out, Deb, Elizabeth, myself, Chris, whoever their email it comes from. We'd like to send these out just so you have it. I know Deb sent one out for Giles already. However, Chris, would you mind reading the obituary for Giles? It just feels better to read through it. He's got a nice setup there with his, a few nice photos with him and his wife, and just him just relaxing. And it's just nice. I know it's kind of a negative thing to start the lunch hour with, but we want to make sure that we go through and any lost ABC Seamless member, we want to make sure that they're brought up in our meetings. So Chris, do you mind reading that first one?
Yeah, no problem. You want to pronounce his last name, because I do not want to pronounce it wrong.
It is Giles A. Patnode.
Okay. Deb said it is Giles A. Patnode.
Okay. Giles. However, I'm wrong there too.
Gillis.
Yeah, age 90 of Brooklyn Park, passed away peacefully on November 19th, 2020. Preceded in death by his wife Marjorie, son Stephen, sons-in-law Rick Capel and Don Bolin, brother Warren Patnode, and sister Glenda Glaus, survived by children Cheryl Bolin, Brian Sue Patnode, and Julie Capel, daughter-in-law Vicky Patnode, 10 grandchildren, 28 great-grandchildren. Wow, that's amazing. That's sister Fern Ingalls, special friend Wanda Kittleson, many nieces, nephews, other relatives, and friends. Private family service with internet at Glen Haven Crystal. 28 great-grandchildren. That's a big Thanksgiving right there.
Yeah, and it's sad to lose you. I didn't know you really at all, but I know that a lot of people I've talked to, you had a role at ABC, and really sad to see you go. I'm going to read Gary's. I did talk with Gary quite a bit. He was, anybody out there on the call still that's watching this or listening, he was always more difficult to deal with than a normal person. He was very smart, intelligent, and didn't always like to hear the digital stuff. But the last few years, we've been talking about the digital stuff before he passed away, and he started to realize that, there is a new world out there, and that's what a lot of us are realizing here in the last few years. So Gary J. Calkins, age 55, of Janesville, rode off into the eternity Wednesday, October 14th, 2020. At his home with his loving family at his side, Gary was born in Janesville, March 18th, 1965, the son of Wayne and Carol Jacobson Calkins. At the age of 12, Gary found the love of his life, and they had been together for 43 years. That's fantastic. Wow. Gary married his loving wife and best friend, Brenda Simmons Calkins, on October 5th, 1987 in Janesville. They were blessed with three daughters, Tasha, Beth, and Stephanie, and Gary owned and operated ABC Seamless of Janesville, working in and around the Janesville area, upgrading homes in the community. He enjoyed wintering in Florida with his wife. You could always find him riding his Harley or blasting out his neighbors, playing his stereo so loud or as loud as he could. Gary had a gigantic heart and even enjoyed Jack and Coke on occasion. He will always be remembered as a strong, driven workaholic, loving husband, father, grandpa, brother, and good friend. An amazing man has left us. No way to count the lives he's touched. No words to express how much he'll be missed. He's survived by his wife, Brenda, children, Tasha, Brandon, Levine, Beth, Jeremy, Harwick, and Stephanie, and Adam, Taromino, grandchildren, Caleb, Chelsea, Aubrey, Jaden, and Blake, siblings, Deborah, Ron, Ryder, Calkins, Hackett, and Kenneth Hawkins, and many extended family and friends. And Gary is preceded in death by his parents and sister, Cindy Stark. And hopefully you guys all have a good lunch hour here. And we'll be back to build positivity back at 1 o'clock. But really sad to lose any ABC Seamless family members. If anybody wants to add anything, we'll open up to you guys at this time. Everybody enjoy your lunch.
Sounds good.